Welcome to Highbury Congregational Church on this Sunday, the 26th of July. Come, let's worship. As with every week, I want to say thank you to all those who have participated in today's service, supporting our music with the reading and with prayers, and also to our IT person who makes sure that we get a first-class online service. I'm going to be going on 3 weeks of annual leave and a much-needed rest, and we will be taking that time to renew. Thank you for your love, your support, your prayers over the last 4 months, and I'm delighted to be able to let you know that we're going to have a rich feast of worship leading and preaching over the next couple of weeks. It begins on the 2nd of August with the Reverend Dr. Janet Wooten, no stranger to Highbury. She's going to be leading us. And then on the 9th of August, Mr. David Waters, who's also homegrown and well-known to the Highbury Church, he's going to be leading us in our worship. And then we're going to have our former minister, the Reverend Dr. Richard Cleaves, and Felicity Cleaves, leading our worship on the 16th of August. So there's a lot to look forward to. I would ask that you would continue to pray for our technical support team as we prepare to gather for worship in September, and also for those who are making sure that we will gather together and meet again COVID-19 secure. So as we gather for worship, we come before God, who is gracious and who is loving. God, who rejoices with us, who celebrates with us, but also who weeps with us, who forgives us when we've got it wrong. In Psalm 119, verses 129 to 136, we read, "Your decrees are wonderful, therefore my soul keeps them. The unfolding of your words gives light. It imparts understanding to the simple. With open mouth I pant because I long for your commandments. Turn to me and be gracious to me, as is your custom towards those who love your name. Keep my steps steady according to your promise, and never let iniquity have dominion over me. Redeem me from human oppression, that I may keep your precepts. Make your face shine upon your servant and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears because your law is not kept. God is gracious and loving. God is a God of reckless, amazing love. And so we're led by High Spirit in singing the song, Reckless Love.
Oh, O God, mere words cannot convey what a privilege it is to be heirs in your kingdom as we explore your world today. Help us to learn about new treasures as well as old. May we see the amazing things you can do in our lives. We are part of your kingdom, and we come to you in awe and wonder. Amen. Lord God, sometimes I feel so set in my ways. I'm not always ready to give something up to gain the thing of value that you promise. Forgive me, Lord, as I open my heart to you. I want to keep my treasures locked up in a storeroom, safe from prying eyes. Forgive me, Lord, as I open my heart to you. Sometimes I just expect things on a plate. I'm not always ready to work for something that you call me to do. Forgive me, Lord, as I open my heart to you. I do want to be the yeast in my world, but I'm not always ready to be pummeled or to give up my easy life. Forgive me, Lord, as I open my heart to you. Sometimes I take my eyes off you and feel so lost. Bring me back, please, Lord. Forgive me, Lord, as I open my heart to you. Amen. Marvellous and mighty Lord, we are forever grateful for all the good gifts you give us, for eyes to see, for ears to hear, for a brain to understand, and a heart to love. We praise you, Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and for ever. Amen.
Hello, I'm Angela. And I'm here today instead of Andrea, who's having a holiday. Monkey would like to say hello to two little girls. Hello, Lauren and Chloe. Today, we're going to think about hands. Most of us are very lucky to have two hands. But have you ever stopped to think of all the different things you can do with your hands? Even this morning, I'm sure you've already used your hands for lots of different things. Perhaps you had some buttons to do up, or a zip when you got dressed. Then you had some breakfast, you had a cup to hold, or a spoon, or a knife, or a piece of toast. Then you might have washed your face, or cleaned your teeth. Lots of different things we can do with our hands. And there's a children's hymn about Jesus' hands. Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good to all, healing pain and sickness, blessing children small, washing tired feet and saving those who fall. Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good to all. And in the Bible, there are quite a few stories about Jesus using his hands to help other people. Once he saw a blind man who couldn't see. He went up to the blind man, put his hands over the man's eyes, and when he took them away again, the man could see. There was a little girl who was very ill in bed. She didn't want anything to eat. She lay there and she couldn't move. Jesus went up to the little girl, took her by the hand. She opened her eyes. She got up. She got out of bed. And she wanted something to eat. And there was an old lady who had a fever and hadn't been at all well. And Jesus went up to her, just touched him with his hand, and she was better. Lots of people wanted to listen to Jesus' stories. And When the young children went, they would go to the front and listen. And he would put his hands on their heads and give them a blessing. He loved little children. And sometimes, when his friends had walked a long way with sandals along the dusty roads, Jesus would take a bowl of water and a towel and kneel at their feet and wash their tired, dirty feet. Jesus had very kind hands. Today, our craft is something which I received a few months ago in an envelope. And it wasn't this envelope, but when I took it out, what did I see? It was a hug in an envelope. And it was for my granddaughter. It says, "To Grandma and Grandpa, hello, love from Jessica," and hugs and kisses. And it's a lovely hug. And when I couldn't see Jessica, my granddaughter, for a long time, because we haven't been able to see a lot of people we love, and we haven't had many hugs, I used to put the arms around me and imagine I was having a hug from Jessica. So I'll show you what you need to make a hug in an envelope. You'll need thin card or stiff paper. So start with the body, a circle. Circle, you can use a different shape, but a circle is a good shape. And just like Jessica, she stuck a photo of herself in the middle and put hearts around it. You can either draw a picture of yourself or get somebody to print a little photo. And then you could put flowers or glitter or any decoration that you want around the edge. And then that's your body. Then you need two long strips of stiff paper or card. These were 4 centimetres wide and then anything between 30 and 40 centimetres long. And you take it and you concertina it. Just fold it backwards and forwards so that they spring out. So you do both of those, concertina them, so they're ready. And then you need hands. So draw around your hands. You put your right hand down and draw around it with the other one, and then put your left hand down and draw around that, or get somebody else to draw around it for you. But don't draw two right hands or two left hands, because that would look very odd. And I found that the hug I got and another one for my grandson didn't stand up very well. So when I made mine, I sent some to my grown-up daughters. I put a flat edge. So if they've got a flat edge, they'll stand up much easier. So that's what I suggest you do. So you decorate them first, then you've got your body, which has got the photo or a picture and decorated. And then you take the arms and put one there and one on the other side. And don't forget to decorate them first. Jessica put some stamps along hers, and when I sent mine to my daughter, because she likes languages, I found out about 20 to 30 ways of writing love and wrote those. So decorate the arms to make them pretty, however you like. But sellotape them to the back. You can use glue, but I think sellotape's stronger. So we did that. And then the other end of this long arm is where you put the hand. Make sure you stick it so that the flat side is down, and then you've got your half a hug. You can do the same with the other side. And don't forget to write a message, who it's to, or what you want to say. I miss you, see you soon, lots of love. And I'm sure if you put that in an envelope and send it to somebody, an auntie or a friend, somebody you haven't seen for a while, they'll really love to have a hug from you. We'll finish with the second verse of Jesus' hands as a prayer. So let's put our hands together. Take my hands, Lord Jesus, let them work for you. Make them strong and gentle, kind in all I do. Let me watch you, Jesus, till I'm thankful too. till my hands are kind hands, quick to work for you. Amen.
Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like this. A man takes a mustard seed and sows it in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it grows up, it is the biggest of all plants. It becomes a tree, so the birds come and make their nests in its branches. Jesus told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like this. A woman takes some yeast and mixes it with 40 litres of flour until the whole batch of dough rises. The kingdom of heaven is like this. A man happens to find a treasure hidden in a field. He covers it up again and is so happy that he goes and sells everything he has and then goes back and buys that field. Also, the kingdom of heaven is like this. A man is looking for fine pearls, and when he finds one that is unusually fine, he goes and sells everything he has and buys that pearl. Also, the kingdom of heaven is like this. Some fishermen throw their nets out into the lake and catch all kinds of fish. When the net is full, they pull it to shore and sit down to divide the fish. The good ones go into their buckets. The worthless ones are thrown away. It will be like this at the end of the age. The angels will go out and gather up the evil people from among the good and will throw them into the fiery furnace, where they will cry and grind their teeth. Do you understand these things? Jesus asked them. Yes, they answered. So he replied, this means then that every teacher of the law who becomes a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who takes new and old things out of his storeroom.
Spirit of God, come, give us eyes to see, ears to hear, hearts to understand the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Amen. The parables of Jesus, his stories, were not for the casual listener, for the entertainment of the masses. The parables of Jesus held hidden meaning, and for those who had a desire to understand, those who questioned Jesus, those who pressed in as disciples, Jesus gave insight into the kingdom of heaven. In Matthew chapter 13, there are 8 parables. 2 of those parables are told and then later explained to a small coterie of disciples. 6 of those parables are comparisons. The kingdom of heaven is like the first. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, the smallest of all the seeds, and yet grows into a great tree. It grows to be 6 to 10 feet tall, or 3 meters if you like. Now we know that the mustard seed is not the smallest seed, but in Jesus' time it was proverbial for the smallest seed. And here we have an insight into the kingdom of heaven. It starts with the very small, with one man whose life and death and resurrection, one man whose friends surrounding him are sent into the world to make disciples, one man whose life becomes a great movement, a great tree, and all the nations of the world come and nest in her branches. I don't know if any of you like gardening, but there's something about planting seeds. You put them in the ground, and there's that moment when you think, are they going to germinate? Will they grow? And I know sometimes there's that temptation, should I just dig it up to see if they've sprouted yet? What do you feel like when you planted the seeds and you wait? And you wait. And then the plant pushes through the soil and begins to grow. And then there's the harvest. What does the harvest of your garden taste like to you? How do you feel about eating your own potatoes and carrots and beans and tomatoes? From the very small grows the great. And it is a hospitable kingdom. God's love has enough room for all the birds of the air, for all the peoples of the world. God's kingdom is hospitable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast leavening the dough. Have you ever made bread? You measure out the flour, little pinch of salt and oil, a little bit of sugar to make sure that the bread goes a nice golden brown on the crust. And you mix together the ingredients. The yeast goes in and the warm water, and you mix it and you prove it and you wait, and it doubles. And then you braid it or put it into loaf tins, wait for it to rise again, and then put it in a hot oven. Can you smell the aroma of fresh baked bread? Oh. And yet there is that moment when you think, will the yeast do its job? Because you can't see it working away. The kingdom of heaven is like that. We can't always see God's love at work. We don't always understand God's ways. And yet there's something in that parable of Jesus that assures us that even when we cannot see hints of God's kingdom, he is at work, leavening the world, his love pulsing through every atom. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast. The kingdom of heaven is a treasure. A man finds a treasure and he wants it badly. So he buries it in a field. He doesn't tell anyone where it is, but he knows that he wants that field because there's a treasure in it. So he goes and sells everything that he has so that he can raise the funds to buy the field. And when he buys the field and possesses the treasure, he is filled with joy because the kingdom of heaven is worth our all. The kingdom of heaven is like someone who discovers the best pearl of all, a precious pearl. And she knows its value and sells everything that she has to buy that pearl. The kingdom of heaven is worth our all, worth everything. It's worth selling everything, giving up everything. The kingdom of heaven is a treasure, a pearl of great price. The kingdom of heaven is like fishing boats that go out with a net, a drag net between them. It's like deep sea fishing. And in the ancient world, these boats sailed alongside one another and dragged the waters and brought up the fish, some fish good, some fish bad, to be discarded. They would take it into the shores and divide it up, the good fish into the baskets, the bad fish taken away and burnt. The kingdom of heaven is indiscriminate. God's love is indiscriminate, and gathers everyone in. And it is only on the day of judgment when the good, when those who are children of the kingdom of heaven, and those who are evil, those who resist God's good ways, God's love, God's kingdom, his justice, it's only then when there will be that separation. Jesus then says to the disciples, do you understand my parables? Yes, we do. No problem. They said, well, you're just like the scribes. You're the scribes of the kingdom. Now, the scribes were those who taught the law. So the disciples are the teachers of this new law. They are the ones who are going to go into all the world, making disciples and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded. They are the ones who are going to go into the world, baptizing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And they are going to be the scribes of the kingdom of heaven. And the scribes of the kingdom of heaven bring out treasures old and new. Jesus, the one who did not discard the law of Moses, but fulfilled the law of Moses. The kingdom of heaven is like. There was a man who was an art collector, and he had an only son who shared his passion for art. The Great War broke out, and his son went off to the continent. The telegram arrived saying that his son had been killed in battle. Sometime later, a young man turned up at the door of this art dealer and said, I knew your son. He saved my life. The old man was devastated. He wept, and to see the one that he had been with during his last moments, he could hardly contain himself. The young man said to him, he said, your son was dragging me to safety when he was shot. I don't have anything to give you, but I do have this sketch. I drew it of him. We were the best of friends. So, sir, will you please accept this sketch? The old man took the sketch. He was so grateful. Thank you, thank you, thank you for this. And that sketch became part of his art collection. And anyone who came to see his display, he always pointed out the sketch of his son. It meant so much to him. The old man died, and as per his will, there was to be an auction. Well, all the art dealers in the world, there was an air of excitement. They traveled far and wide to come to this auction. There were some treasures in this collection. The auction began. The auctioneer had the sketch of the deceased's son put on display, and he said, this is the first item to be auctioned. Can I have 10 pounds, 10 pounds, anybody 10 pounds, 10 pounds, 10 pounds? And the room was silent, and there was an impatience in the air. 10 pounds, 10 pounds, anybody 10 pounds? Somebody said, we don't want this sketch. It's not worth anything. Just, can we get on with the other stuff? The auctioneer said no. The man's will said that this sketch had to be sold first, and it will be sold before we move on to the other items. So the auctioneer continued on. 10 pounds, 10 pounds, anybody 10 pounds? And a hand went up at the back. It was the art collector's gardener. And 10 pounds was all he could afford. The auctioneer waited for a time. 10 pounds, 10 pounds, I've got 10 pounds at the back. Anyone want to go any higher? 10 pounds, 20 pounds, 20 pounds. But no one wanted to bid. Going once, going twice, sold to the man at the back. Well, there was a kind of relief in the room, an excitement. Now they could get on with the real business. And then the auctioneer declared, the auction is now over. It was a gasp. What? It was in the man's will that whoever bought the sketch of his son would have the whole of his art collection. The kingdom of heaven is like. It is small. It is unseen. It is treasure. Do we have the eyes to perceive the value of the kingdom of heaven at work all around us? Can we see past all of the things that are valued, the things that we think are really important? Are we willing to give up our all to have the most important thing of all, the most important one of all, the Son of the Father? Do we have eyes to see? Do we have ears to hear? The kingdom of heaven is near.
So many songs, listen to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it all. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony, you are singing over me. The Father's song, perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me. Now you're singing over me, the Father's song. I have heard so many songs, listen to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it all. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony, big mystery. The King of Love has sent for me, and now you're singing over me. The Father's song. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart.
Loving Lord, as we think about your kingdom, we long for the justice, joy, and peace it promises. At a time when it can seem as if the world is still a precarious and challenging place, we pray that you would help us to focus on you and on what we can do to live as you want us to. Help us to understand how our choices affect others all over the world. Keep us mindful of our responsibilities to each other and to the planet. We pray for those who are working towards the sustainability of our world, those who educate about climate change, develop green energy and other technologies, address waste and review global economics. Help us to learn from this time of crisis, to recognise what is important and what is enough, what we need and what we need to do without. As the school holiday season starts, we pray that families would be able to have rest and fun. We pray for safe and responsible travelling. We think of those facing a transition over the summer, to a new school, to university, out of education and into work. Be close to them in this especially uncertain time. May it be a peaceful and positive experience. We pray for those all over the world who have concerns around their jobs, businesses and finances. We pray that they would be given the practical support they need to live comfortably and support those who depend on them. We think of the live entertainment industry, theatres, music venues, festivals. Thank you for the joy and challenge these entertainment forms can bring to us. And we pray that they would survive through this time to delight and challenge us again. We think of church leadership teams, especially ours here at Highbury. We pray for wisdom and discernment, for a robust assessment of the variety of views, needs and considerations. Help congregations to be patient, supportive and cohesive, acting in love and care for one another. Finally, we think of those who are distressed and in pain, those who are physically unwell, injured, tired, or facing investigations and treatments at a particularly challenging time. For those who are dying and cannot be near all those they hold dear. For those who are psychologically distressed, anxious, depressed, lonely, overburdened, confused, abused. We pray that you would bring healing and peace, comfort and safety. Lord, may your kingdom come on earth as in heaven. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Thank you.
as we seek the kingdom of heaven, as we gain a glimpse of the mystery of God coming to us in Christ, we go with the words of the Apostle Paul to the Philippians. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen.